You're listening to a podcast from digitaloilandgas.com. This podcast is entitled Canada's LNG Projects, Another Year, Another Delay. When might Canada's LNG projects get sanctioned? Potentially sooner than conditions suggest, but only with a good overhaul. Here's why. LNG is really a study in patience. The future of the LNG industry will be the subject of a presentation I'll be making in Calgary later this year. Having spent 4 years in Queensland, Australia, working among the four big projects there, that is to say three that are in production and a fourth one stalled on the drawing board, I have a view as to what conditions need to line up for big projects to proceed. Frankly, conditions are still murky, and boards will likely wait and see how markets evolve before sanctioning any of the Canadian projects. Meanwhile, a dose of digital thinking will help get costs in line. Why would the boards not sanction projects? Well, first is because of prices. Boards like to see strong pricing forecasts, but LNG prices have been down for some time, with no turnaround in sight. Prices for contracted LNG, that is, not spot LNG, are linked to the price of oil in a formula agreed by the buyer and the seller. Canada's LNG shipments would most likely head to Asia, where LNG prices are determined with reference to the average price of the top 20 crude oils imported into Japan's refineries. This price index is called the Japan Customs Cleared Crude, or JCC, and is affectionately called the Japan Crude Cocktail, not something you'd want to drink. In case you've been off the planet for the past 36 months, you know that the price of crude has tumbled from a high of $100 a barrel in late 2013 to just above $50 today. The JCC has not been immune to these market forces, and Japan is mercifully paying much less for crude oil as a result. But, by extension, LNG prices are down. Not by the same 50%, though. LNG contracts frequently have a floor price. But it's still enough to throw the profitability of new projects into doubt. Contracted LNG prices, therefore, must await a turnaround in oil prices. The latest forecasts are for oil prices to hover around this $50 to $60 range for the next 24 months or so. Spot LNG prices could offer some respite, but it's unlikely that boards will be able to sanction a $20 billion capital project that is solely exposed to a highly volatile spot market. Project financing lenders will want some certainty that they'll get paid, and too much spot exposure makes lenders nervous. And by the way, contract LNG prices in Japan in December of 2016 were around $8 per MMBTU, with spot prices a little above $8.50. Assume it takes about $2 per MMBTU to ship LNG to Tokyo, another $2 per MMBTU to recover liquefaction facility costs, $1 in energy costs, and at the plant. That leaves about $3 per MMBTU to be split by the gas supplier, the toll to ship gas to the coast, and the royalty take. No matter how you slice it, margins are going to be razor thin for everyone in this scenario. And by the way, $8 is actually a pretty generous price. Last fall, contract prices for LNG were just $6, and spot was at $4.50. Unfortunately for LNG projects, though, supply is about to balloon out. Markets look like they're going to be drowning in LNG supply. Back in 2012, LNG trade was 327 million tons, according to BP's energy statistics. Starting in 2015 and continuing through 2017 and into 2018, one new 4 million ton LNG manufacturing plant comes online every other month or so. This equates to an incremental 1,200 cargoes of 150,000 cubic meters of LNG over and above the 2012 supply. You have to ask where all this supply will go. It hasn't hit the market yet, and still prices are down. There's also a considerable amount of demand uncertainty. With all this new supply coming to market, it has to go somewhere. Some will replace existing contracts that come to an end or to replace the supply from any retiring LNG plants, although I'm not aware of any LNG plants that have been mothballed. LNG demand appears flat starting in 2011, when 330 million cubic meters of LNG exchanged hands, according to BP. Fast forward to 2015, and trade is still just 338 million cubic meters. Since a cubic meter of LNG is about one half ton, trade appears to have increased by only 4 million tons. Trade is not demand, of course, because trade is capped by supply. LNG can't be stored for long, and it degrades during transportation. and few new LNG plants came on stream between 2011 and 2015. So while we can't really tell what the true demand for LNG might be, presumably all those LNG cargoes are accounted for. But perhaps not. LNG demand is driven by the addition of new burner tips, that is, whole new markets of consumers, or burners that run longer in existing markets, as when there's really cold weather or perhaps really hot weather. There's the occasional announcement of new regasification plants, but nothing close to enough for this tidal wave of supply. Next problem for boards is that costs are too high. The cost of delivering an LNG project in Australia has been very sobering for the boards that have to sanction the Canadian projects. While in Australia, I had opportunity to benchmark global LNG projects to understand their break-even costs. We concluded that the Queensland LNG projects required a 20-year average market price of $16 per MMBTO, destination Tokyo, just to break even. The Western Australian projects were not much better, ranging between $12 and $16. Compare that to today's market price of just $8. We broke the LNG project costs down into upstream CapEx, which is drilling gas wells, building gas plants, and building pipelines, downstream CapEx, building the LNG plant, jetty, and tanks, upstream operating costs, which was for running gas facilities, downstream operating costs, that is running the LNG plant, and shipping costs. We wanted to zero in on specific changes that an LNG project would need to execute to reduce the break-even costs. Our calculations showed that to reduce the lifetime break-even cost by just $1 required far more efficient capital execution in Australia. The capital investments, that's plants and pipelines, would need to be built 25% faster. Another calculation revealed that upstream operating costs, that is maintaining the wells and all the flow lines, would require a 75% reduction over an expected 20 years to reduce the break-even costs by a further $1. The large Canadian LNG projects look suspiciously like the Australian projects. They have the same owners, the same development models, same overall designs, a large megaton tidal plant, big transcontinental pipelines, greenfield gas, and harsh locations. The Canadian projects, unless they do many things radically differently, are going to have broadly the same cost profiles. Applying digital technologies to this challenge would make a considerable dent in project economics. My conclusion is that the supply, demand, pricing, and costs do not favor expansion of the industry at this time. Now, meanwhile, I do keep an eye on a number of developments in the global oil and gas sector for clues about the timing of Canada's great LNG hope. First is OPEC. OPEC's agenda to reset oil prices higher by constricting supply and the degree to which members comply. So far it's working, but OPEC has proven itself in the past incapable of holding the line on production for long. Number two is Russia and the level of cooperation between OPEC and Russia. The Russian oil and gas industry can be cajoled by the Kremlin to work with OPEC and trim production a bit. Russian oil reservoirs aren't as easy to swing as OPEC. Russia could use the revenues, though, by keeping prices high. Number three is Aramco. The success of Saudi Aramco's IPO and its potential to boost pricing. The Saudis want Aramco to have a strong IPO to maximize the treasury, so trimming supply really helps. Afterwards, however, I wonder how responsive Aramco will be to market pressures. Today, they need only respond to the king. Number four, stockpiles, and the amount of oil in storage and in the pace by which it is monetized, which helps keep pricing down. Something like 300 million of barrels of oil are in storage, a volume which is material to the overall market. Number five are inventories, and that is the activity in the US and Canada to complete the big inventory of drilled wells. The North Americans have thousands of wells that need fracking services to get into production. Incremental oil volumes may boost supply and then depress oil prices. Next up is drilling. That's the level of light, tight oil drilling activity in North America, a resource that has transformed capital velocity and intensity. These wells are faster and cheaper to get into production, unlike a big offshore resource that can take years and billions to bring online. Next is the North Sea, and the success in the North Sea to reset its costs and keep the basin active. OPEC's price management agenda is actually aimed at killing off big additions to base supply, like the North Sea and Canada's oil sands. Next, I keep an eye on Japan, and specifically the moves by Japan to force its LNG contracts to be renegotiated. Japan needs to unwind its long LNG contracts to better match its shrinking domestic demand. Another one I watch is shipyards. The activity levels in Korea's shipyards that are building all the floating regasification ships for many new markets. These new markets will want faster, cheaper, and flexible floating facilities rather than large, fixed plants. And finally, deregulation. And that is the success of Japan, Korea, and China to deregulate their gas and power sectors, which could open up fresh gas demand. The big Asian markets need to reduce carbon emissions, and deregulating gas and power markets are key to getting consumers to switch over to cleaner fuels. So these are the things that I watch. Keep an eye on them, and these will provide you with good clues as to whether and when the Canadian LNG projects will be sanctioned.
You have been listening to a podcast from digitaloilgas.com. If you like what you've heard, please subscribe to future installments and visit us at digitaloilgas.com.